Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Lynn Richardson, and I'm the co-director of the Institute for Health Equity Research. And it's my pleasure to welcome you to the IHER seminar series. On behalf of my partner, Dr. Carol Horowitz and I, we are really delighted to have a very engaging speaker who's talking on a very important topic. She has some great information to share with us. And so we really can't wait to get started. I do want to just say that the Institute for Health Equity Research is now a little over 2 years old. We are growing. We continue to pursue our mission to conduct practice-changing, paradigm-shifting research that eliminates disparities, dismantles racism, and helps us all to achieve health equity. So with that said, I'm going to introduce our speaker for today. Kizzy Charles Guzman is the executive director of the New York City Mayor's Office of Client and Environmental Justice. Her team delivers climate leadership and programs focused on sustainability, decarbonization, brownfields remediation, resiliency, and environmental justice. Kizzy has spent over 15 years of her New York City service career developing and delivering work at the intersection of environmental policy, public health, and racial equity. She led the development of Cool Neighborhoods NYC, the city's first strategy to address the impacts of rising temperatures and heat waves, and several adaptation initiatives to ensure that New York City residents are ready to withstand and emerge stronger from the impacts of climate change. Kizzy served as deputy director at the New York City Mayor's Office of Sustainability and Climate Resiliency, as director of the Climate Change and Health Program at the New York City Department of Health, and as a policy advisor on air quality during the Bloomberg administration. She has received the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency's Environmental Quality Award and a Champion of Change Award from the U.S. White House in recognition of her work. She's a graduate of Carleton College and the University of Michigan at Ann Arbor, and I am delighted to introduce her to speak to us now. Thank you so much for joining us, Kizzy.
Thank you so much for having me and for that kind introduction. I really appreciate everyone's time on a late afternoon. I don't take it for granted at all that you're choosing to be here to talk about this important topic. I aside from the very kind words in that intro that Dr. Richardson shared, I just want to say one extra thing about me, which is that I'm a New Yorker. I immigrated to New York City as a young person. I went to high school in Brooklyn in the 90s, well before it was considered a safe and hip and cool place. And I was an unpaid intern at the Brooklyn Botanical Garden, which exposed me at a very early age to what it meant for environmental resources and amenities to be gated and exclusive, while just a few feet away, right, we had Rossing Park, which was considered dangerous at that time and did not receive a lot of funding support. So the reason I'm sharing that is because I want you to know that a big part of what I bring to my experience in city government is my lived experience. And I think that that is so important when we talk about equity and we talk about justice and talking about folks being, quote, at the table. We really need to find and create more opportunities, right, for young people that have the lived experiences that exacerbate health outcomes and that really show us health disparities and put them in positions of decision making and put them in positions of power and position of being able to be those sharers of information in communities. So I'm very proud of that. I take it very personally because it was my lead into public service was knowing that as a young teen, I noticed disparity. And so I am working every day to create a city where infrastructure planning and funding decisions don't intentionally or inadvertently expose people to environmental pollution or to poor housing conditions or health disparities or displacement or inequitable access to open spaces. I am really thrilled to lead a team that is really thinking through how to create thriving neighborhoods rather than seeing disparities in environmental quality from block to block. So I do have a few slides. I wanted to do this as a bit of a sharing of a story about some of the initiatives that I've been part of over my time in city government. And I wanted to give you guys an introduction to my new office, which I was recently appointed to when Mayor Adams came into office this January. I was appointed at the end of January in a new combined role. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about that. So let me go ahead and share my screen and get us going. Everybody can see this okay? Dr. Richardson?
You're going to have to hit display settings.
Yes.
Yes, thank you, Kizzy. And if you could speak up just a little bit louder, we want to make sure nobody misses anything you say.
Well, thank you for that feedback. Great. Okay. Is this better? Dr. Richardson's nod. Yes.
Yes, it is. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. So we at the Mayor's Office of Climate and Environmental Justice are a team of architects and scientists, engineers, policy advisors, lawyers, and city planners that are working, again, to create a city, right, where our almost 9 million residents have access to clean air and clean water, green infrastructure, and importantly, the resources to build sustainable and resilient communities. Everyone in our office recognizes that climate change is real, so there are no deniers here. Everybody understands that climate affects everyone, but also that its impacts of climate change are not equally shared. And we're committed to taking bold action to protect our planet and communities. We believe that regardless of background or circumstance, all New Yorkers do deserve a clean environment and opportunities to thrive. So again, our work is at that intersection of sustainability, resiliency, climate policy, public health, and now racial equity. Before this January, we were actually four separate offices. There was an office of resiliency, there's an office of climate and sustainability, and there was an office of environmental remediation. They do the brownfields land use cleanup. And then there was the office of environmental coordination. And Mayor Adams reorganized us and put us all under the same umbrella with me at the helm. And I think that reorganization was really about thinking about the efficiency that we could create if we ensure a high quality approach that's centered on climate justice and that is really centered on environmental health. And having that coordinated action across these formerly siloed entities that New Yorkers don't understand why they were siloed in that way feels like the right approach for us to actually meet this moment and confront the climate crisis head on. So my team is developing world-leading climate policies and programs. And we're very popular sometimes, but mostly everyone is mad at us a lot, which is how we know we're doing the right thing. The idea is to address the drivers of climate change and achieve environmentally and economically just outcomes for all New Yorkers. So we are preparing for a variety of climate hazards. And so what's so frustrating to me is that when we think about climate change, we think about, you know, carbon mitigation. If you're on the sustainability space, you're thinking about carbon. And if you're in the resiliency space, you're thinking about flooding and Hurricane Sandy. But really, as a team, we're preparing for a variety of things. Yes, coastal storms, which are projected to become more frequent and more destructive over the years. Sea level rise, which even if there's no coastal storm, we see neighborhoods across New York City that every time you get an inch of rain, the water table is already so high that they experience flooding in their basements, or they experience flooding on the street. So we know that increased tidal flooding and groundwater table rise is already happening in our neighborhoods, and we are preparing and addressing those conditions. We are preparing for increased flooding in non-coastal areas, so inland flooding from just rain. And of course, temperature, which I'm going to spend a bit more time discussing today so that we can really see that connection to health equity there. We are preparing there in that case for the longer and more dangerous heat waves that are more intense over time. So these are the projections here in the center, and the pink circles are the projections from the New York City Panel on Climate Change. So, as we're preparing for a multitude of threats, what's very clear is that our most recent events validate the need for multi-hazard strategies, right? So whether it was Hurricane Isaias or the 2020 summer, 2021 heat emergency we declared, or Tropical Storm Henri or Hurricane Ida, we have had a variety of events hit our city in a consistent way. And all of these are result in disaster declarations with significant impacts. Even if not a lot of people die during these events, the bottom line is that people do things like lose power, right? So say in the case of Hurricane Isaias, we had power outages for Con Edison customers in New York City and Westchester, which again, if you're someone who relies on electronic medical equipment, a power outage that is significant and long in duration is a natural threat to your health and safety. And so these are the kinds of things that we call cascading impacts from some of the climate events that we have endured. And of course, who can forget with heat, we have emergency room visits and heat-related illness, which of course is our greatest threat every single summer. So our approach is to create multiple layers of protection. And so what that means is, again, trying to really go beyond thinking of climate preparedness as that seawall, right? Like that a barrier, coastal barrier. We're talking about green infrastructure and building code updates and building level protections. We're talking about raising awareness about the importance of having insurance. We're talking about public awareness about the importance of checking on neighbors and each other during periods of extreme heat. Like, so all of those are tools in our toolbox that we spent a lot of time developing and trying to promote. We are seeking to stretch our resources by aggressively pursuing federal and state funding. And that is difficult, right? But there's so much conversation about, oh, there's federal funding available. It's like, yes, but also we are putting skin in the game. And I will give you an example of that in just a second. And the way that we are centering equity and environmental justice is really about having that flat out recognition that communities of color and low-income communities are hit first and worst by climate change, right? They recover slower and they have less access to economic opportunity, which allows them to just pick up and move or stay safe during periods of extreme weather. And so we are really trying to target our resources to those that need it most to ensure that our climate solutions are at least centering equity in some way. And lastly, we're trying to not create these what we call false solutions, right? We want to make sure that our sustainability work is resilient and that our resiliency work is sustainable because they're two sides of the same coin. So to transition us a second to some of the work we did on heat, you know, the health department in partnership with, so our scientists at the health department in partnership with Columbia University scientists developed this map. It's called the Heat Vulnerability Index. It describes risk in our neighborhoods. Here are the five boroughs of New York. In darker red, you see that there is higher vulnerability to heat illness and mortality. And areas that are lighter colored, like in yellow, have lower vulnerability. This does not mean that there aren't vulnerable groups in every single geography. Of course, we have vulnerable groups living in every single neighborhood. Those are older adults, low-income people, those that have chronic health conditions like diabetes or renal conditions, and then those with mental health illnesses. And so what this map does, though, is help us focus our attention on what are those determinants of risk in those communities. And so this map is actually made up of five variables. Our index is made up of five variables, some that describe the physical environment. So the percent of the neighborhood that is covered in tree canopy, right? So percent of the canopy cover, the temperature, the average temperature in the area, but also there are variables here that describe social risk. So we have incorporated into this income, right? So the percentage of the population here that is receives public assistance, the percentage of the population here that is Black, non-Hispanic, and then also the percentage of the population that does not have access to air conditioning. And we call those social factors that really would exacerbate heat risk, even if everything else was the same. So these are validated through the literature, right, as being the most significant indicators for heat risk in New York City. And so we use that map as our basis. It gave us the onus of where, if I only have $1, where would I spend it to make the most difference in terms of the health outcomes I want to see in order to reduce health disparities. Luckily, I am a great negotiator and I did not have a dollar, I got $100 million. And so what we did was launch Bold Neighbors New York City in 2017. This was over $100 million of investment in targeted tree planting and other strategies in those red areas of the map that I showed before. So here are just some examples, because everybody loves a before and after photo, of just what a difference it makes just 5 years after planting a tree, right, on the shape of the street, just because of the shading potential that a tree can provide. And so what that means is that if Mrs. Smith is on the five-story walk-up and is enduring a heat wave trapped in her apartment because she thinks the street is too hot, and so she does not want to actually leave her home to go to a cooling center, the tree planting, creating these cool corridors across the city actually might help shift that, right? Because we're saying, hey, we're going to provide this shaded path for you to be able to stay safe, but ideally we want you to be safe indoors in your apartment. But if that's not possible, the street shouldn't be the thing that keeps you inside, and that will have a negative health impact at the end. We also targeted our Cool Roofs program, again, in an effort to bring down local temperature in the city. We targeted it in those neighborhoods that, again, were in that red, in those red zones. So here's an example of NYCHA housing. This is public housing in Brooklyn before and after we coated it. And so again, the idea is that you have these black tar roofs absorbing and trapping heat, making the building even hotter, needing even more air conditioning, except that many NYCHA residents have a barrier to accessing air conditioning within their apartments. So what we're saying is, instead of creating these pockets of tar absorbent, heat absorbent materials, let's go ahead and use a reflective surface instead, right? And so we coated those rooms white, and we have this program across New York City. We have a target to coat at least a million square feet of roofs, of white roofs every year. And we have been exceeding our expectations, our goals. So we do this for organizations that provide supportive housing services for free. The city coats them for free. We coat them for free in high heat vulnerability neighborhoods. We coat them for free if they bring us a cluster of buildings that are together, so that again, we can really harness the benefits of several roofs at the same time. And again, the idea here is, let's bring down the overall temperature in the neighborhood, even incrementally, it will make a difference for those folks that are living in those high floors apartments. Whoops. And then improving the public realm. Again, here's an example of our schoolyards. This is all black tar, just asphalt, and the after, which is serving as a stormwater retention, green infrastructure, neighborhood amenity, right? So converting all of these underutilized schoolyards that were just heat trapping into places that actually become community assets. So that's our schoolyards to playgrounds program. So I also wanted to share a little bit about our experience around COVID. This was back in 2020 when the first set of maps came out showing us where we were seeing high rates of COVID infection and mortality. And when I first looked at those maps back in March, April, I am noticing that the map looks exactly like my heat vulnerability map. And that makes a lot of sense, right? Because conditions, the social predeterminants of health disparities or of health outcomes, right, tend to be race and income. And so it makes sense that the neighborhoods that are hardest hit by COVID at that time were also the neighborhoods that are hardest impacted by heat vulnerability. So even at that time, as we're in full-on mode of emergency response and management, trying to understand and come up what is happening with this virus, I start to worry about a few months later for the summer, because this was going to be the very first summer that we were going to ask New Yorkers to stay indoors. We were not going to offer the usual respite options that we would have, right? The cooling centers, the senior centers, opening the city pools, opening the city parks. Even the beaches were closed at that time. And I was really concerned that on top of the COVID mortality, we were going to see additional mortality because of heat. And so we quickly tried to cobble together a program that would distribute air conditioning units across New York City to vulnerable populations. And we did that. This gray hair patch over here that was trying to do that, this gray hair patch over here was absolutely trying to coordinate across the very many city agencies that rolled up their sleeves and helped us make phone calls to deliver the 74,000 air conditioners. This was no small feat, but this was $55 million almost overnight trying to get these air conditioners installed and getting these low-income seniors serviced, which was really, really hard. And you can ask me a lot of questions about that if you're interested. So I guess what I wanted to leave us with, I have a lot to leave us with, but you know, it's really the center of the work that I want to do and that I've been interested in doing is about addressing inequality. Because what we see is that even on an environmental focus, inequality exacerbates climate risk and environmental risk, which in turn has this rippling effect on public health. So even though we, our office thinks of ourselves as like, oh, you know, we address flooding risk or heat risk, the truth is that what we don't want, all of those climate hazards have these secondary hazards, right? Displacement, sewage overflow, mold, decreased air quality, right? That then has short-term outcomes, right? Injuries, interruption of care, mortality, but then also long-term outcomes, exacerbation of chronic diseases, mental health stress, right? So we actually see ourselves, or I like to see my team and myself as public health practitioners at the core, because the most elemental thing is the air we breathe, right? The spaces in which we inhabit, whether those are indoor spaces, outdoor spaces, the places where we live, work, pray, and play. So those are the kinds of initiatives that we want to be able to center as a team. The next example I wanted to cover was our work on air pollution. So this is one of those initiatives that really made a lot of people mad, because ultimately changing the way that our buildings operate is very expensive, right? We have these clunker boilers, legacy systems that are 70 years old. They're burning the worst type of fossil fuel because it is much cheaper than to do cleaner fuels. But we ultimately had to ban it and say, we are no longer going to give permits for the combustion of this type of heating oil. So we were able to pass those policies and regulations, put them in place, even despite all of the real estate concerns and opposition, and were able to phase out fully the number, all of the buildings that were burning number six heating oil ahead of schedule. So by 2016, we were able to announce that all of the buildings that were using this fuel had discontinued its use. Let me show you why that matters. Here are our, here's data from our Department of Health. They manage the New York City Community Air Survey. Those are air quality survey monitors across New York City. Here are sulfur dioxide winter averages, which is the main pollutant you get when you burn heating fuel. And here's the, it's a little bit hard to read, but there's only one thing you're supposed to get from this photo, which is at the top, you have the first winter of monitoring. That was 2008 to 2009. And you can see all those brown areas of the city where the winter average is high, over five parts per billion. And now you can see all the way to winter 2015 and 2016. Over time, you see how that brown decreases over time. So our pollution load is coming down a lot. It doesn't mean that there is no more sulfur dioxide in the environment. It just means that it's decreased significantly over time since we first launched the monitoring system. And now, just by doing that one policy action, which was phasing out the use of number six oil. And here you can see on the right for 2015, 2016, when you really zoom in, you see that the level here, the parts per billion are really, really reduced, right? So our first scale was up to 5, and this one is 0.3 to 0.11. So it doesn't mean that there's none, but it is so much lower, and that has a significant and real impact on people's health. Now here is PM 2.5, even harder to see, but our particulate matter load coming down dramatically over time, again, as the result of this one policy change. And so this is why we get up every morning and do the work that we do, because we wanna see more maps like this. This is the thing that helps us have healthier populations, which in turn means thriving neighborhoods, better economies, right? Like no one wants to sit in a classroom while having an asthma attack and actually learn. So we actually have to clean up the air that those kids are breathing in order to be able to ensure that they can be full participants in their school experience and their education, but also in their in the economy as they become adults. It doesn't mean, again, with PM 2.5 that there isn't much work to be done. Here you can see a clear photo of 2017, our map. Look at our highways. Our highways are the thing that is red. Midtown, Manhattan, and all that traffic is the thing that is red. Our industrial sites are the things that give us that red. And so what our team does is take this data-driven approach and try to identify new opportunities and new solutions and new policies, much to the chagrin of the private sector. But we love it. And again, this matters a lot because as more research comes out, right, we know that, you know, this is an article here, or a headline of an article from 2020, showing that COVID-19 patients in areas that had high levels of air pollution before the pandemic were more likely to die from the infections than patients in cleaner parts of the country. So again, I know I'm preaching to the choir now, but it's like really that, that the fact that inequality and environmental burden is the great determinant, right, of who lives and who dies, it's such a grounding thing for us. We want to make sure that everyone has a, quote, leveler playing field by virtue of a cleaner baseline, and the cleaner baseline is their environmental baseline. So I'm almost done here. Just wanted to share a few wrapping thoughts, and then we will do Q&A. You know, my overall thing is that the built environment and planning decisions impact health and perpetuate racial and economic inequality. Bar none, we are, the moment that we are okay with policy and investment decisions that either intentionally or inadvertently perpetuating health disparities, we're doing the wrong thing. We should be doing the opposite. We should be addressing and redressing health disparities, environmental injustice, and racial inequities. For whatever reason, we should all be waking up in the morning and saying, this is my contribution to racial justice. We believe that everyone has a role to play in this because the problem is too big, right? And so ultimately I need to address the systemic issues, especially racism and segregation, but by every discipline, right? We need the medical doctors, we need the professors, we need the policy wonks and the bureaucrats like me, right? We need the activists, we need the young people. So multiple disciplines are needed if we're going to actually devise climate smart solutions that are also more just. And then I would just say that, listen, we don't need more research, and that's an unpopular opinion. And we also don't need more community engagement. That's also an unpopular opinion, I am sorry. What we actually need is our trusted messengers to be our fiercest advocates for justice. And everything in the literature tells us that our most trusted messengers are our medical doctors, the meteorologists, and our pharmacists. Like, healthcare professionals have such an important role to play in anti-racism and climate and health activism. So I ask you and challenge you to join networks that allow you to also make a difference. there are so many toolkits now. The U.S. Department of Health and Human Services put out a toolkit about resiliency of the hospital and the healthcare system. There's Practice Green Health. I'm going to drop some of these in the chat, some of these links afterwards, and I will share them, although you probably already know them well and work with them. Healthcare Without Harm. Medical Society Consortium of Climate and Health. I mean, I tell you that this is such a difference. I've been in this work about 16 years, and I see a huge difference in the activism of the medical community today than there was 10 years ago. They are saying that racism and climate are the threats of this generation and the next. The threat of the planet is a formidable threat, and putting their bodies on the line. And so to me, that just fills me with hope, because I'm like, yes, yes, where have you been? It's been 10 years of this. So I really love it. And there are so many ways to get involved, precisely because it's not only, right, the systems from within which you operate, right? Like the impact that healthcare facilities have on environmental pollution, significant, too much waste, too many fugitive emissions. Your buildings are inefficient and put out a lot of stuff that communities have to breathe, right? And all of that is part of healthcare delivery. And that is incredibly important, but we should have healthcare without harm, right? Whether the harm is coming from idling ambulances or idling delivery trucks that are bringing in tons and tons of materials every single day into the facility. So there is something about the building in itself that is unsustainable and that can be improved. And we so look forward to more healthcare organizations being partners in decarbonizing and their operations and making their buildings more sustainable. But guess what? That starts with you guys asking for that change, because you're the one spending time and having those conversations and joining those boards and joining those networks is a way of doing that. But also you're the organizations that talk to people, talk to New Yorkers. And so delivering that preparedness information, you're actually our first informers, right? They don't wanna talk to me. We're the bureaucrats. There is low trust in government. We need those trusted messengers to really be out there talking about what New Yorkers and what Americans and what global residents should do to keep each other safe and to stay safe themselves. And then lastly, I just want to leave us with two last thoughts. One is that mental health is physical health, and you know that well. But one thing that I see also as an educator is that this climate dread and anxiety and eco-nihilism are real, especially for young people. And I think that there is something here we really have to pay attention to as practitioners, right? We need to pay attention to how young people are experiencing this crisis and our actions or inaction around climate. And we need to ensure that their depression rates and their suicide rates and that their anxiety rates aren't the thing that impede them from being full actors in helping turn this thing around. So I'm saying we have to turn the thing around, but we wanna make sure that the next generation is actually also able to sustain themselves. And so we have to just watch for that. And lastly, some of the hardest work we do in state government is actually trying to figure out how to give grants to community organizations so that they can do what they do best. And that is to lead on climate, hold our feet to the fire, continue to be fierce advocates, and keep their neighbors safe. And city government is very wonky at doing that. We simply cannot dole out these tiny grants or these huge grants to all of these organizations. We need you guys in the middle to do your partnerships and do that support and to do that advocacy, right? Like how many of us, if I could see you, say raise your hands if you know a funder, somebody that works for a foundation. Those foundations should be providing direct support and assistance. The foundations that your host organizations, in this case, Mount Sinai, the tremendous amount of work and support that they provide to community organizations, how can we activate them also for climate and health purposes, right? So again, that kind of partnership has to go both ways. And what they ultimately need is real resources to be able to get the work done that, frankly, government can't do. We're going to be the last ones to get there and the first ones to leave. But those neighbors, they stay and they will be the main source of support and recovery for our communities. And so I think it's just so important to think about that. So with that, I just want to stop and thank you again for your time and for having me. And I would be glad to answer any questions.
Well, thank you, Kizzy, so much for that. I think this audience is especially attuned to your call to action, that you not only gave us information about the situation and the efforts that the city has been undertaking to address the climate change crisis, but also really calling us out to do our part as healthcare professionals and as researchers to help you and your office do this work. So if anyone on the webinar has questions for Kizzy, please put them in the Q&A section, which you should have access to on your Zoom controls, I guess. And while we're waiting for that, I have a question. So I was very interested in where you started at the beginning in talking about how several different separate offices were combined into a single office now to address this. And I think this fragmentation and this working in silos is sort of a repeated theme across every aspect of health equity work, that the way we're going to solve these complex problems is not by everybody sitting in their own little silo worrying about it, but by really bringing all of the resources and all of the talents and all of the disciplines together. And I like that you sort of called us out at Mount Sinai. So what would be the best way to try to engage with your office? We are at the Institute for Health Equity Research. I mean, we're a group very diverse in terms of disciplines, but all passionately committed to achieving health equity and very aware that all sectors affect health, right? That the answers to achieving health equity are not in healthcare, but they are in housing and food security and environmental justice and in all of the things that affect the conditions in which we live. And I'm especially interested in your, call to sort of partner with community organizations. So is that a model we should be looking at? We have a big group of community partners of various kinds that we've worked with. Is your office someplace that we could come to with a proposal for something that we think we could change? Or should we be looking for funding elsewhere? What can the city do to sort of catalyze action?
Yeah, great. Thank you for those questions. I'm going to try to take them in pieces.
Yeah. No, it was comments and questions.
Yeah, like comments and questions. I want to just plus your comment about the siloing. And I think to me, that is really such an annoying threat. It's a threat to the work being the best work that it can be.
Right.
Right. Because you have your little grant, your research project, and I have my little grant, my research project, and maybe we're competing for the same NHS grant. Right. And then you come to me at government and you say, I need a letter of support. And then suddenly the thing is due. And I have to write 14 letters of support for 14 different scientists across the city who all need a city partner. I'm like, it's not a partnership if the thing is due tomorrow and you're asking me for a letter of support, right, today. But here's the thing. Ultimately, I think we need to figure out, I think the climate crisis is a different kind of crisis and it is a formidable one. And I think the silos don't help. And I do think we need interdisciplinary dialogue because the solutions are actually not just tech, not just policy, not just partnerships, not just research. You are putting a band-aid on the problem if we are talking about managing asthma. By that point, the kid already has the asthma. You know what I would prefer? For the kid to not have the asthma, right? Mold, same thing, right? Like I would love to not have to spend, you know, to give yet another letter on a program about integrated pest management education and all of that. At that point, let's actually get into a conversation about housing, right? And how do we do that? And I think that that is hard. I think it is hard to enter a space and feel like we have authority over that space, and that we're not sticking our neck out as opposed to the organization sticking the neck out. But I do think that centers of research like yours, and again, the politics of y'all's setup, but we have to start somewhere, yeah, right? And so how does this, I can never say this name, the Inca, how does Mount Sinai contribute to climate change less? So how does it mitigate the outcomes, the health outcomes of climate? How do we engage that board? You tell me, like, that's a partnership I want to have. I want to sit with your president and your director of facilities, and I want them to sign our carbon pledge. The White House just also just launched a partnership. You say you're going to make a plan. You're going to commit to reduce your emissions by this amount, doing certain kinds of actions. Practice Green Health does it also. That's a private thing, right? Like, there are many ways that you can do the same thing. We can talk about, look at Dr. Horowitz putting me to task. Yes. Right? Like, I think that we can absolutely do, it's not just the research. It's like we are our own best advocates inside the organizations in which we sit. And inside the organization where we sit, the way that we break down some of these cells, we say, okay, well, what are the sets of solutions that we think are needed so that we stop seeing patients with these kinds of outcomes? Okay, we need policies. Well, what is our organization's perception or perspective on that? And is that just an intergov conversation and decision, or is this driven by the medical professionals behind the work and behind the outcomes you're seeing? So I am available to you anytime. I'm happy to engage in any way that you find is helpful, if it's helpful. I ultimately think that what we are trying to do with the community partnerships, for example, is like, we can't fund you to do this work, right? But there are others who can. And frankly, you're loaded too, okay, as an organization. So what we're saying is these tiny grants to this community organizations, like again, we launched a buddy program and it was three nonprofits that are community, like core community organizations. So they're the trusted messengers. They have deep roots in that community.
Absolutely.
Right? Like, and we decided to give them a tiny grant. And it was such a pain to get that money transferred and for them to do all that paperwork because of the city. It became very onerous. But really, someone else could have given them that money. And here's the outcome that we had. It turns out that we launched this thing, we gave them climate training. We provided support. We said, okay, the idea is check on your neighbors during periods of extreme heat, because I think of it as a muscle, right? You're exercising a muscle. The heat emergency is going to happen four times per summer, even more. So if you practice during the summer and you activate this network of volunteers to check on each other during the summer, then when we get a next Sandy, you're already going to have those relationships. You already built that social capital. That was the idea. It turns out that they did that. It started as a sleepy group, but you know, three organizations, staff, partner organizations. They identified over 1,000 climate susceptible residents and recruited 66 volunteers, just these three organizations. And that sounds like a small number, but let me tell you that we activated them during COVID. During March and May, they did all of those checkups, and the pickup rate for them, so that's the number of people that actually picked their phone, was 92%. That is unprecedented. Me, a bureaucrat, would never achieve that on my own, because climate buddies knew their neighbors and their neighbors picked up the phone as opposed to the 311, right? Like 75% of the residents they assisted were over 55, so vulnerable population. 65% of them lived in subsidized housing, and a majority of them were Black and Latina women. All of those buddies were Black and brown women doing this work. Isn't that incredible? And so again, like when we think about those partnerships, like you already have a standing partnership, but maybe what they actually need is a small grant, and maybe it's easier for you guys to dole out that, maybe it's not. But I would be curious to have that conversation, how we partner on initiatives like this.
Yeah, I think we're definitely gonna wanna follow up. I mean, you were perfectly right to call out Mount Sinai. We've actually already had conversations with the health system leadership. You'll be pleased to know they have signed whatever it is, the pledge that some healthcare organizations have signed, yes, about actually reducing their carbon footprint and so on. And we, so that is actually happening at the institutional level, and we'll be keeping an eye on that to make sure that's not just lip service, but that they're actually doing those things. We recognize Mount Sinai is a major community institution. Probably the largest employer in the area. And we are very mindful that Mount Sinai really has responsibilities in all of its roles to really promote the health of our communities and to promote racial and ethnic equity. So we could not agree more. But we also have a large, this now is our institute, a large community engagement core. And I think that the kind of programs you're talking about to really engage people on the ground in communities, in organizing to help keep themselves and their neighbors safe is a model that, you know, could be replicated and then evaluated so that there's, you know, there's evidence that this works so that further investments can be made. So I think we will definitely be following up with you, Kizzy. I'm going to the question and answer board now. So we do have a question. Does your office or another New York City office also support environmental education in low socioeconomic areas such as NYCHA housing? And if yes, could you speak about these efforts in more detail and your sustainability plans?
Great. So I can do this at a high level. The answer is yes. We support and engage a lot with through our Department of Education, which has some of our the country's leading work on environmental education and kind of demonstration projects in the country, I want to say. And the thing is there, we have legislated ourselves into our climate targets in a way that really means that we have to put our money where our mouth is. So yes, we pass policy saying our buildings have to be efficient and we have to have solar panels and we have to have pool roofs and green roofs for the private sector, but the city did that for themselves first. So our schedule for compliance has always been more aggressive, right? We've done this since it was Mayor Bloomberg's initiative, and we were doing that work again. At the time, Mayor Bloomberg's idea was always like the city must lead by example, and we have stayed true to that charge. So the reason why I'm bringing this up in the context of environmental education is that actually our school buildings are more and more, right, like having to be the ones that are leading that transformation of the built environment because they're part of our building stock. And the city of New York is required in a fast schedule to retrofit and make sustainability improvements to our own buildings. And that is an incredible opportunity because it means that students are actually seeing, right, these technologies at play. They can. And I'm not saying we're doing all that we possibly can do, but those partnerships do exist, both with nonprofit organizations and being partnered with DOE, Department of Education, has a Department of Sustainability. That is, it does a difference. We didn't have that before. And so they do think through climate resiliency, climate adaptation, climate mitigation strategies. And as I think the question also said something about NYCHA, and the answer is yes. So we partner with, say, Green City Force. We are partnering with community gardens. We want to make sure that we are training the next generation also, right, of New Yorkers. And so we are not just stopping at the schools. We are engaging in, you know, I've never sat with Mayor Adams that he didn't bring up green jobs as like the in top priority. And he does not want me to have any policies that aren't really focused on how is it that we're going to grow the pipeline, right, of training opportunities for New Yorkers and young people, especially those in low socioeconomic status. Currently, that's the only way that we're going to get them out and into the middle class, which is so important to the mayor. So we're constantly focused on that, and it is hard, and we're not doing a perfect job at it, absolutely, but we're working on it.
Okay, thank you. Do we have other questions from our audience?
I also put some links in the chat and just wanted to share them with everyone if you haven't had a chance to look at that. A couple of them are the medical societies that are propping up to support some of the climate and sustainability work. So that's exciting. They're really taking some of these policy positions nationally and helping to raise awareness on that and creating fellowships that then help support cities and states to do research, right, that is climate focused. And so that's also an interesting model to think through.
Okay, so I see Carol is really re-raising
yes.
the issue of how can we as researchers work with you? We think we do have special skills. We have yep. quantitative skills and evaluation skills. We also, as I said, have a real network of community-based organizations with whom we've done research in the past. So what are the questions that you would like to see answered so there was evidence that some of the things you're doing make a difference, that they have an impact? Are there knowledge gaps that we
yeah.
should be focusing on? And as you say, writing grants to other sources to get
yeah.
funded to do the research that you
yeah.
need to
yeah.
really understand how climate change affects health, especially in the most vulnerable communities.
Okay. Let me put it to you this way. Again, the first part of the question is, how do we as researchers work with you? You call me. I'm here. Tell me, what is the research project you want to do? Explain to me why it's so important and why is it a knowledge gap?
Okay.
Because I guess, again, my perception is we have so much research.
Yeah.
We have so
yeah.
much data, and we don't need any more proof that Black and Brown communities are bearing a disproportionate burden of environmental pollution and health outcomes that are undesirable. And so I think ultimately what we need more of, perhaps, is actually the social science part of this research, right? So like how an evaluation of programs, that could be a thing as well, maybe. What is hard for me to wrap my head around is that I don't think that climate change can be solved with more scientific evidence. I think that we have a lot of that. We work closely with the New York City Panel on Climate Change, which is a set of researchers across our major institutions. We can make connections there also. And the science to us is very clear as to the impacts that we're seeing. What we don't have a lot of information, and let's call it an information deficit. It's about power relations. Ultimately, people want to keep their economic and political power. People think that they can like, oh, I'll just slap a solar panel on this thing and I can still be driving my huge car, or I could still fly 100 times. You know what I'm saying? Like the standard of living that we are accustomed to and that, we have created is not sustainable across the entire world for the time that we're in and for what is coming with climate change. And so part of this is, how do we actually try to capture, right, the social dimensions of climate change? Because I am very, very tired of people constantly saying things like, those are co-benefits. What we really need to know is how much energy are we doing, right? And so like there is such an overemphasis on physical sciences and climate science that I think that we're forgetting that ultimately we're doing this for people and that people are experiencing those impacts and that they have a lot to share with us, right? As to what are the right solutions and what kinds of things they want to see. So maybe I would say some of the knowledge gaps are on that social aspect of the equation. I think people are overstudied in their communities, and I think at least from my vantage point, the policy wants to know what we need to do. But no, most New Yorkers don't want us to do those things. They're expensive, they're unpopular, it means you have to change your life. And that is hard.
Yeah, I think culture change is difficult always. And mm-hmm. I think that's true whether you're talking about climate justice or racial equity or dismantling racism, that those really are the obstacles, sort of the Herculean tasks that are before us. We do believe, because we are researchers, that data can help drive those yes. actions. But you're absolutely right, the data are not enough. And we say this all the time. We don't, for example, not really interested in doing research to document more health disparities. We have reams of research on health disparities. We're
That's right.
interested in understanding what are the solutions to eliminate those, and how do we formulate those kinds of interventions and evaluate them so that we know what works. It's not just a good idea that we're investing in, but we're actually investing in something that we have evidence will achieve the kind of results that we desire. And a lot of it really is changing the way people think about how they live their whole lives. And I think it's true in all of those arenas. So it is clear that there's a lot of work to be done. One last opportunity for our audience to ask questions if they would like to.
Now that you've said that, it triggered a thought, if I may share it.
Please.
While folks write their last question in the Q&A. You know, I would give you one last example of like this thing about the evidence base. Is it there or is it not? In 2015, and I'm looking around because I'm looking for this plan, we put out a plan that said like we are going to try to develop or set a maximum temperature threshold in buildings in order to address heat vulnerability indoors.
Okay.
So the same way that we now have, right, like it's when it's 40 degrees outside or October 1st, whichever happens first, the landlord is required to provide heating. And we call that a public health, like there was a public health reason why we have that in the code, housing maintenance code. We said similar thing. There is a temperature threshold at which we must provide air conditioning. And then everybody hummed and hawed, oh, there isn't enough research. There's no evidence base. You know, if I am a healthy, you know, white male, my body responds to heat very differently than if I am overweight and da, 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 right? Like all of these questions about why we couldn't set a temperature threshold. Is 95 degrees too hot? Is it 82 degrees? Right? Like, how do we capture what is a safe level of heat to be exposed to? And that question has never been answered. And we have just been shut down the whole time. And we had to reconsider the initiative and everything. Because again, even medical professionals are like, absolutely not. Like too many confounding factors there. How did we do it for cold then? Right, well, like we're at a point yeah. where we're like, we're experiencing yeah. more heat and severe heat waves. What is the temperature at which you would tell me I have to cancel that marathon so we don't have people passing out outdoors from heat exhaustion? Like that, to me, like that is such an interesting question that seems like it's the third rail and nobody wants to touch it. And I'm sure it's difficult, but this is why I'm like, I don't know that we need more data. We just need the right of like, as government, I need you to tell me when do I take an action or do I cancel an action, right?
Well, I share your frustration. In a more private setting sometime, possibly over drinks, we can
yes.
talk about when do you cancel a marathon, because I've been around long enough to know that that is not a scientific question. That is a political question.
Exactly.
And I think a lot of public policy, you know, it is always weighing not just the health risks, but also the financial implications and the, you know, the impacts on all of the stakeholders involved. I mean, that's really what creating public policy is.
Yes,
I submit to you that there's no more science that went into the 40 degree choice. We have as much data on the other end of that as we had on the cold end when that policy was put into place. So again, I'm not sure we need more research, but the political will to actually do something. And the difference is that all buildings in New York City, almost without exception, have some kind of heating system. Not all buildings have air conditioning. So what
That's
does
right.
that even mean to say
yeah.
that landlords are responsible when the temperature inside a building gets too high? They mm-hmm. they have no mechanicals in the building to cool it.
Yeah.
So it's a much thornier problem, but the same kind of health implications.
Absolutely.
Well, this has been great, Kizzy. I'd love to talk to you more, and I suspect there will be follow-ups.
Yes.
I'd like to thank you again. And I thank all of those on the webinar who have joined us, and hopefully you have been energized and inspired to start thinking about what it is you can do in your science, in your community, in your professional organizations, in whatever roles you have. What is it you can do to really start to make a dent in this crisis, because it is indeed a formidable problem that is facing all of us, and we're just not paying enough attention yet. So thank you so much. And to everyone else, thank you for joining. This will conclude our Institute for Health Equity Research seminar for today. Bye-bye.
Thank you.